elks, leopards, buffalo, elephants, and rhino. Come on, give us another migrate. Look how carefully he's watching us. I think she, is that a she or a he, Brian? Can you tell? I'm going to train my binoculars because if it's a she, I think she's probably still pregnant. Here's a he. I can tell that, Ryan, by the way the oxpecker's pecking at his neck. You see that? You can tell that it's a he. The length of his tail, yes. And Dan, a great question, of course, related to what we've just been seeing. You say, do we ever see great animal numbers of migrations here in South Africa? We don't, Dan. Animals do not migrate in huge numbers here. And that's largely because of things like you've just seen, the water that you've just seen. You saw the pan of water there. And that pan of water is the reason that the wildebeest don't have to migrate here. There's water everywhere in the Sabi sand. And so they certainly used to migrate in this area, but they don't anymore. And they've become largely sedentary. This bull is now marking his territory. So he's got glands between his toes called pedal glands. And so he leaves himself a little scent there. And that will be his, the center of his little territory. This is wonderful. This really is a beautiful wildebeest sighting. And of course many of you will be expecting those huge migrations out here. It just doesn't really happen like that. Now I don't know if anybody can remember, but I can't, when it is that a little wildebeest horns erupt. But I think it's probably about a month. Yeah, Jean, you say how many wildebeest babies are there this year? Last year there were 11. This year we don't have that many. Let's count them, Jean, in this herd, and it could might be a different herd. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You try and count them, everyone. I've only got 5. There's one lying down there at the far back. So 6 or so. There are 2 lying down there, 7. So if you go to the left there, Brian, behind those knobthorn trees, even further back, yeah, those ones there, there are 2 on the ground behind them. So I think we've got 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We've got 8. There are 2 there, aren't there? Or just 1, there are 2. So we've got 8. What are these things shouting at now? That's an alarm call. But they're not known for their intellectualism, these wildebeests. So it's possible that they're alarm calling at a baboon walking past. There's the bull. Now he's kind of wasting his time. I mean, obviously all of these females have got new babies. They're not about to mate with him. And they're clearly not very, or he's clearly not very worried about the same things that they are. There we go. The migration seems to have begun from behind them. No idea what they're looking at. Can't see anything behind me. What are they looking at? It must be the baboons. We'll go back and have a look just now, but I'm just so enjoying the sighting of this herd, which is so unusual for this area. We just don't spend a lot of time with wildebeests. And if your questions aren't getting through, everyone, it is because we are still experiencing one or two troubles with the internet in the final control. And hopefully that'll all be sorted out in the next little while, if not today, tomorrow. And if you're wondering about Taylor, she's having to come home as well, I'm afraid, at this stage. Marvelous stuff. They're still doing their little alarm calls, but half of them are now lying down. Should we do a little swing round, Brian? Let's just turn gently behind us. Oh, there are elephants up there. They surely wouldn't have been alarming at them. Well, I saw one elephant. Did you see it? It's a long, long way away through there. We can probably go around and have a look there. You see them through there? Oh, brilliant. Well spotted, Brian. Look how hard the wind's blowing. I'm sure there's going to be a storm sometime tonight. It also does not bode well if you happen to be a little wildebeest. And there are lions on the prowl. I wonder... Let's go around there, actually. I think let's go and see if we can't have a better sighting of the elephants. We've had a wonderful wildebeest sighting. Thank you, wildebeests. Let's go around the other side there. Gallego Pan is just around there, and Herbie thought maybe the lions had gone towards there. And I think in a wind like this, they might get going a little earlier than they would otherwise. Please stay away from the lions, wildebeests. I don't want to see any of you eaten. You are far too few. Now, we were talking about great migrations of animals, and I'm just trying to remember if I'd finished that discussion. I think I had. Basically, the answer is no. Not in South Africa. We used to have big movements of zebra and wildebeest before the advent of artificial water points, but not anymore. I'm going to get up over the dam wall and see if we can't catch up with that elephant who seems to be heading towards the pan. And I don't think they were alarming at him necessarily. I mean, why would they alarm call at an elephant? But they are not, as I say, known for their great intellectualism, so maybe they thought it was something else. Just looking in the pan to see if there are any unusual birds, which there don't seem to be, just some Egyptian ducks, as Brian called them earlier. Mind Warp, you reckon we need a mobile tech ambulance? Yes, I think that's absolutely correct. We do. But this is why, you know, it's one of the reasons that we do this every single day, is because this technical challenges behind doing what we do are enormous. They really are beyond imagining, and it's one of the reasons that very few broadcasters are prepared to do live wildlife. Because you've got this mobile setup that's moving around all the time. There are thousands of moving parts. And, I mean, if you watch some of the live stuff done in Britain, there's almost no movement from the cameras. Their cameras are set up in one spot, and there's a little bit of movement and a little bit of broadcasting, but it's... They don't do this kind of stuff because of the technical issues. And that's why we do it every single day. So that when it does come for TV, come time for TV, we've hopefully ironed out as many gremlins as humanly possible. As far as I understand, for TV as well, we stream out via satellite. So that's a little bit more reliable. There he is. He's right here. Should we go up, Brian? What do you think you've got in there? Dan, while we sit with a single elephant bull, you're wondering what the very largest group of animals I've ever seen on Djuma is. I think I probably saw it this morning, Dan. It was a very vast herd of red-billed quillas. Now, red-billed quillas are little finch-like birds that Byron was telling you about yesterday evening and showing you a picture of. And they occur, I probably saw 400 or 500 of them flying past in a flock. I mean, they occur in flocks of millions. They would be the most numerous animal. The most numerous mammals would definitely be herds of impala. I mean, we get herds of impala here of, well, regularly in the wintertime, they would reach 200 animals. But if you really want a big herd of mammals out here, a very dry season and a big waterhole will net you possibly 1,000 buffalo. Now, I've never seen 1,000 buffalo here, but it is possible. Brian, I know that elephant is quite entertaining, but just above it, you can see a rather spectacular picture of the moon and the clouds moving underneath it. Isn't that amazing? It's gorgeous. Looks like it's on the sea, doesn't it? A moon floating on the sky sea. That's very unpoetic, said poetically. Yes. Brian? That was called a pregnant silence. Did you like it?
I enjoyed it.
I liked it too. Let's see if we can get another view of the elephant. Oh gosh, that's very bumpy. I don't think we're going to get another view of this chap. We might. I'll just wait here in case we do. Donovan? You're wondering if elephants have hair. That's the very last time I'm going to say you're wondering when we get a question. I'm going to find another way to introduce the question. As of now. Donovan, you are concerned that perhaps elephants don't have hair. Elephants are, of course, mammals, and by default, therefore, they must have hair. They've got hair on the bottom of their tails, and you'll see this chap's coming out now, and you'll see he's got hair on his eyebrows. And if you look very, very carefully at his forehead, he might have a little bit of hair left there. Does he? Sometimes they do. The youngsters have got lots of hair on their foreheads, though. There we go. A little bit of stubble. And Louise says, a little bit of fuzz. It looks like fuzz, but it's actually like wire. Now, this is a young bull, very much the same age as the one that Brian and I spent some time with this morning. Probably about 20 or so. And he's having an interaction with us. He's a little bit nervous, but he's just kind of testing what we want. So I'm not going to start the car now. I know it's not the best picture, but we're going to stay here while we answer Pete's question. Pete is interested in the... There we go. Is interested in the difference between an African and an Asian elephant. Well, that is an astounding picture of the pachyderm skin. Pete, the differences are many. They're actually from a different genus entirely, so the same family, but the genus of the African bush elephant is Loxodonta, and the genus of the elephant in Asia is Elephas, as far as I'm aware. And the major morphological differences are the fact that an African elephant has got much bigger ears. An Indian elephant's got small ears because it spends most of its time in the shade, actually. And then, I mean, the African elephant is bigger. Only the male Indian elephant has tusks, whereas the African elephant both have got tusks. And physiologically, a big difference is, I think, that the African elephant apparently has to eat a huge amount more, because the soil out here is nutrient poor in comparison with Asiatic soils or Asian soils, which are largely volcanic derived. This is very ancient granite that we're on here. And therefore, most of the vegetation here doesn't have the same nutrition that it would in an Asian jungle, say. And therefore, a huge animal like this got to spend a lot more time pushing food through its digestive tract than an Indian elephant would have to, or an Asian elephant. And that means that an African elephant, and perish the thought, is very poor for work. They don't work well because they have to eat too much. Now watch his behavior. He's looking at us carefully. He's just kind of saying, I'm not really that comfortable with you. I'm a bit nervous. So he turned and he kind of shook his head and almost said, you know, why are you here? I'm just trying to feed quietly on my own and I'm not sure that I want you around. Well, I'm afraid he's going to be slightly disappointed, because we are going to follow him a little bit, mainly because I think he's heading towards the waterhole that I want to go and look at. Those lions are going to be around here somewhere at some stage. Now, Daniel, I think, are you a new viewer, Daniel? It's very nice to have you with us if you are. Well, it's very nice to have you with us even if you aren't. You say, do elephants live in pairs or alone? Neither, really. The bulls do live alone most of the time, the old bulls. Young bull like that, I suspect, will join up with some bulls the same age as him in not too long. And then they're kind of temporary arrangements of friends that don't last forever. But the old bulls do kind of live on their own most of the time. But the females live in herds, Daniel. They live in herds of related females, normally up to about 20 animals in this area. And once it gets bigger than 20 animals, apparently what happens is that the herd will slowly break off. And for example, we have our very favorite elephant cow out here is one with the bottom third of her trunk missing. And her herd consists of her, probably a sibling, and two youngsters that she's given birth to. So that's her herd, and I suspect that they've sloughed off a bigger herd of, say, I don't know, that's just gone in excess of 20. And that seems to be the best size of herd for this area. Right, Taylor astoundingly has found some signal, and she's back on Djuma, and she's got Brian, and a very exciting thing, eh? Steenbok. Wonderful.
James, thank you so much for looking after everybody while we were racing back from the no signal zone on the Cheetah Plains. Those stinky gremlins are terrible this afternoon. We'll have to get some gremlin off spray sent to us in bulk. Now, we found this little Steenbok, and it's a little male. He doesn't look particularly full grown. His horns still look quite small. And the way that it is moving now, it's sort of slinking through the grass like a leopard. And when you start spotlighting at night time, obviously we're looking for certain things. And I always find that Steenbok and common dacre can often get you a bit excited. You see them when they are slinking away from the spotlight and you think to yourself, oh, it's a small cat, maybe an African wild cat or a serval, just the way that it's moving. And then, of course, it's a little bit disappointing at night when you find a Steenbok because, well, you can't really view them. But during the day, it's a different story. It's not so bad, but he wasn't hanging around with us. He's a little bit nervous, so he sort of spotted us, he looked back at us, and then he trotted off into the thicker vegetation where I think he'll feel a little bit more relaxed, but thankfully there's long grass now. I really do feel sorry for Steenbok and Dacre in the winter months because they do not have much to hide behind at all. There's no grass and most of the trees have lost their leaves, so they really just rely on their color for camouflage, whereas at least now with all this lush green vegetation and all these lovely small shrubs that are popping out, they've really just got to find one of them, sit down next to it, and they completely disappear behind those small bushes. Yeah, but it's lovely. Now, David, where should we go? Should we go to Bubbles Hook Dam? I don't think James has been to Bivol's Hook Dam yet, so maybe we'll, seeing as though we're on Cheetah Cut Line, we might as well just keep heading towards that direction. And hopefully we see something interesting along the way. The other morning when we did the, I think it was when we did the TV show, I very quickly actually popped past, so on Sunday, for Sunday for all of you if you're in America, it was Monday morning for us. I went past Bivol's Hook Dam and I saw a marabou stalk wading around. So I want to actually go and have a check and see if that marabou stalk hasn't perhaps made a habit and will decided to come back into Bivol's Hook Dam. Ah, look at the moon. There's a very quick look at the moon and the Easter Bunny. And if you don't think... David, can you see the Easter Bunny with the ears? You can, hey? I think it really does look like it. And I wonder if I have children, I will tell them the same stories, all the same stories that my dad told me. Right, but let's continue. Let's look for animals, seeing as though we're out on a safari this afternoon. I suppose that's what we should be looking for. Oh. Now, Kathy, you were wondering, speaking about birds, if we could see the white storks this afternoon. We shall attempt to go and have a look that way. David and I actually do have a plan. But what I would like to do this afternoon is quickly go and check Bivol's Hook Dam. And then actually, hopefully, by the time we get there and by the time we come back and arrive at quarantine, the herd of wildebeest and all the impala that like to hang around at the dam during this time of the day have moved up towards quarantine. And then hopefully we're going to do some silhouetted animals this afternoon. That is our goal. So let's keep our fingers crossed that we can do that. We can definitely have a look. Whether the storks are there, I'm not sure. I didn't go past there this morning. So they could have also moved away, but maybe they're still around. And I forgot to tell all of you this morning what we ended our day off with yesterday. So remember how I've been saying how I miss seeing the silhouettes of animals, and this is actually what's brought about David and I returning to quarantine in the afternoon just as the sun's dropped behind the horizon. As last night, as we were just about to come home, pull into the DRC, we see this young elephant bull on the middle of the quarantine plains, and he was beautifully silhouetted with the perfect oranges and sort of purplish blues that the sunset had, and it was really quite wonderful. So hopefully we can do something like that this evening. Well, that's what we're hoping to do anyway. Hopefully the clouds, I've said hopefully a lot now. Now, what else can I use for hopefully? Possibly. I'm joking. Let's hope. We just won't do it. Radio. Everyone teases me because apparently I've been saying radio a lot. And I don't know why I've all of a sudden got into the habit of saying that. Or okie dokes. It's another wonderful cheerio. One. David's just reminding me. I do this thing now where I say cheerio to everybody. Quite strange. But it's funny that we say these things as we go along. And I don't know why we do them, but we get into a terrible habit. We should tell you how many times I say those words. Now, Louise thinks it's now funny to say radio after everything she whispers into my ear. Radio, no, I'm joking. Now, Alex, you're wondering if I've ever seen a dik-dik in this part of the park. Unfortunately, I haven't. I've never seen one before. Can you believe it? There's still an antelope that I need to see. And another small antelope I have seen, though, is an orobi. I've seen three orobi in my whole life. And they were actually introduced onto another, I suppose it was like a little breeding farm they were doing in the Eastern Cape. And there were a couple on there. And often when we drive past on the main road, we'd see them coming out. But you have to look very carefully for them because they're quite a small antelope, too. So no dik-diks are on the list, and hopefully we'll see them at some point. Now, it's obviously tough for game viewing this afternoon because of all of the wind, which is sad, because it's honestly been such a lovely afternoon. It's not too hot, and the sun is just perfect, and there's just the right amount of clouds as well. So it would have been nice if it was like yesterday, when it was, well, I suppose just no wind at all. It was really quite lovely. Oh, very exciting. Rightio, it seems as though James has got a couple of elephants at Galago Pad. Cheerio.
We do indeed have an elephant at Galagopan, and we came to Galagopan. Why, Brian?
To see the elephant.
To see the elephant. That's the same elephant we had, and we thought he was heading through here. So we just drove here and stopped and waited patiently, and there he is in all his finery. That is a ridiculous thing to say about an elephant, of course, because an elephant cannot be anything but in his finery, as he doesn't have a great selection of clothes to wear. It's amazing how wise they look from the time they're born, isn't it? That eye looks like it's seen a thousand things already. There's a nice one from you about bulls on their own and why they like to be on their own. There is a reason. It's one of those questions that I don't really know how to answer because I'm not entirely sure what that reason should be. Bulls don't like to be around other bulls because of competition, and that's of course a function of testosterone, which is the male sex hormone, and of course us human males have got that, and it makes us, it doesn't make us antisocial, but it makes us very competitive with each other. So that absolutely does happen, and I don't think Taylor's sighting is going to go anywhere. She has got something quite interesting for you, but I'm just going to quickly finish what I was going to say there. The other thing is that being around the herd is of no use to them. A herd attracts all sorts of attention from predators and that sort of thing. They eat a tremendous amount of food, they drink a tremendous amount of water, and so it probably is easier for an elephant bull to be on his own, get enough to drink and find enough to eat without the pressures of being around a big herd. All right, let's go across to Taylor. She has got a reptile, but it's not on a tree this time. No, I don't really understand what's going on. Anyway, we're not going to Taylor, we're going to stay here with the elephant. He is now wandering into the bushes, which is very nice indeed. Gorgeous light and wonderful to see him have a drink like that. We'll pop now over towards quarantine and towards where I think I'm going to guess where those lions have gone. Righty, we've got a little bit of time before the end of the drive, so I think we'll see if we can't quickly find those lions. Well, I don't know how quickly we'll find them, but you know, we'll do our best. Are you ready, Brian?
I'm ready.
Did you enjoy that elephant sighting?
I didn't.
I enjoyed it as well. That's a nice sound, isn't it? It wasn't the elephant talking, everybody, it was the noise of Wendy's wheels. Right, we're going to go across to Taylor. She now has whatever it was that she had and is in the right position to show you what it is.
Yeah, and maybe if I tread lightly, it'll maybe move. But I'm confused. It came right behind the senna bush over here. I'm scared I step on it. Where you can see these lovely, elegant locusts. You can see them there, hey David. Aren't they beautiful? A lot of them are mating at the moment. They've gone from being little nymphs into big adults. Oh, here's some mating ones. Oh, David, can you see them? Well, now they can't hang on this string of stars very well. They're a bit too heavy, but they're now on the ground, of course, and they're mating. Did you see that backflip? Did you get that, David? That was very impressive. Hey, my goodness. I want to have one more look for this chameleon. It has to be here. I'm just searching under all of the trees because I don't understand how it disappeared so quickly. It came behind this little thing and I don't know which way it went. I'm not as good as a tracker as Herbie, Because I can't see any chameleon footprints. Oh, I can't believe it. That was so cool. Very angry now. Not angry, frustrated. Where did it go? David, aren't you sad? It's probably sitting laughing at us. I'm just doing one further quick sweep because it was moving at the fastest pace I've ever seen a chameleon move in my entire life. I know. No, it's not here anymore. Oh well. Nope, that's the grasshoppers. Well, that was very brief. Actually, we saw it for a few seconds before it managed to escape us. I've never had a chameleon run away from me before. But let me get into the vehicle. It's a pity, but it just shows you. Everybody thinks chameleons are slow-moving animals. They're quick enough to get away from David and I. It's not great for our egos, hey, David? This is not the greatest. Let me just plug myself back in here. Oh, okay. Well, that would have been really, really cool to see. And I was hoping that he was going to stick around on the road. And by the time that I'd sort of braked and tried to get a good position to see him, he literally just ducked behind that tree. And that was the end of it. And it's quite something, quite special to see a chameleon off its perch and actually moving around. So I'm very sorry that we weren't quick enough. Now I believe all of you are saying that I should have become one with the chameleon and thought like the chameleon. I don't know what chameleons think of us, so that's my first problem. Perhaps I think let's turn this into an interesting conversation. What do all of you think a chameleon would think about? So send your answers through to hashtag Safari Live and or questions at WildEarth.tv. Be as creative as you like. What do you think chameleons are thinking of? And yes, I think, in fact, that we're but we've just jumped onto Bivils of Cutline now. We're just doing a little boundary patrol as well, seen as though James has covered the southern sector. Hello, Deborah, armchair traveller. So the first answer to what do you think chameleons think of? And of course it's from Deborah. Deborah has said that a fuzzy, warm lion's mane to crawl around on. That's a good idea. That's a good one. I wonder if that little chameleon is still bragging about its days of when it used to ride lions. I think that's pretty exciting. I don't think many chameleons can say that. And Steph told the story. Remember, he said he's seen a chameleon that was on an elephant before. Well, I don't know if he told this. He told me the story, or I heard it. That's pretty impressive too. Either riding, if you're a chameleon and you've ridden a lion or an elephant, I think that that's exceptionally impressive. David, I'm not going to go that way. We'll go the shortcut way. We didn't decide to go the scenic route because I actually want to get to the dam as quick as I can. Justin's on a roll this afternoon. Justin, this is the second time you've made me giggle this afternoon, and you've said that chameleons think, be one with the leaf, be one with the leaf. That's a good one. David, what do you think chameleons think of? Come on, you've had some time to think about it now too. I think chameleons think about, oh, my feet are hot as they're crossing the sand, and maybe that's why they do, oh, such exaggerated movements when they do walk. Feet get hot, they need little rubber shoes, little sandals for a chameleon. this is becoming ridiculous, but you know me, the more ridiculous the better. So GDH, you said that chameleons think about what should I wear today. David, have I gone past everything? You guys are making me laugh too much now. I've missed my, what are you doing? It could be a bit further up, eh? David and I are now lost. We can't remember how to do drive anywhere anymore. Laura, you said that the chameleons think of women, song, and drink. Yeah, Suppose so, yes. No, we're not lost today, but we knew exactly where we were going. Right, we're almost at the dam. Now let's keep our fingers crossed that our friend the marabou stork is there. It'll be very exciting. I'll be a very happy girl if we get to see that. And I think we must start a tally, but everybody has to remember, I can't remember, otherwise I'm going to try and not say it. But I think tomorrow morning when we do the sunrise safari, someone should keep a tally of how many times I say the word righty-o. Because I don't believe Kirsten McLennan-Smith that she says I say it so many times. So we shall see, but I'll forget about what I told you now, tomorrow morning. So you'll have to just do it and then remind me at the end of the show how many times I said that ridiculous word. Oh no, I can see a glimpse of the water and I don't see a very tall bird with a big beak, unfortunately. But maybe there's some smaller ones with smaller beaks that we can have a look at. Let's see what we've got over here. Oh, where's the terrapin diving? David, there's lots of them. Look at there. Are those ones mating? What are those ones doing on the... There we go. Terrapin diving, my favorite sport. Those ones weren't very good. But there's two more further to the left that are making... No, to the right now. They're just on the bank. There they go. In they go. That was pretty cool. That must have been the doubles diving team. What do you think? David, out of 10, the first pair? About an 8. Okay, I'm going to be that judge that scores quite low. I'll give them 6.5. And the second pair, I'll give 7. I think they did slightly better. David, what do you give the score?
I'm going to stick with 8
for both. 8 for both. Very fair judge David is. You want him on your team. And we can see he's come up for his second turn there, David. You can see he's just popped out. It's gone from diving, turtle diving, to turtle synchronized swimming. But of course, these are not turtle. These are terrapins that are swimming around in here. Oh my goodness, you just saw a bird flash across your screen. It was a pair of woodland kingfishers, and David, there's actually one still sitting on the branch. I'm going to see if we can get a position. Just have to point our nose off the dam wall a little bit. There we go, can you see it there? Yeah, that's nice. Is this the first bird of the day? Yes, for us, I don't think we've had any birds on screen yet this afternoon. But that is, it's a bit like the circus here this afternoon, because we've got the tightrope walking woodland kingfisher that also wants to be a synchronized diver. That was much better, because, you know, that actually reminded me, and I know I'm being silly now, and I apologize to some of you, is you know how you see the gymnasts after they've done their cartwheels and their amazing twists and turns that they do, and they sort of land, but they always put their arms out and their feet together? And I think that woodland kingfisher, as it landed and perched itself, it opened its wings. Watch, it will do it again. Dive down into water, dip back, double back flip. There we go. And you see, do you see or not what I'm talking about, David? Should I imitate it? Okay, I'm going to imitate what I'm talking about in case you're a bit concerned and you don't understand. But I don't know if I'm going to do a cartwheel, so we'll just pretend that I do a double backflip. I wish I could do one, but I can't. So basically you, la la la, twist. And then you have to do that, and that's exactly what that kingfisher has just done. So in case you were wondering what I was talking about, that is what I meant. But that's enough of the Olympics. And it's doing it again. It becomes easy. That is all I'm going to see now every time I see a kingfisher is a gymnast. Ooh, you may have just heard that bearded woodpecker, that territorial call. It's obviously somewhere in this thicket, I think, but sadly not quite what we were looking for this afternoon, but that's all right. We will move on and see what else we can find. We're going to head towards quarantine now. Oh! Generous Kathleen scored me 8.2 for my performance. Thank you very much. I would have been a little bit stricter. I don't think that I landed my jump very well. And the fact that I was also lacking the twists and turns. I didn't have any ribbons in my hair. And I didn't have a leotard on. Justin gave me a 10. High five, Justin. Thank you. And yes, well, I suppose because I'd been gone for such a long time this afternoon, I needed to come back with a vengeance and try and entertain you in some way to apologize for my absence. So I hope that you all enjoyed that. And I hope that you actually understood what I was saying. And now every time you see a woodland kingfisher open up its wings when it's landed on its perch, you think of course, gymnasts doing their... Well, I can't do it. I didn't get the monkey genes in my family. On a trampoline, I'm not too bad. My younger brother, he's, I don't know what genetics he got, but he can do a backflip just standing on the ground. It's sort of his part. Didn't you see my brother do a backflip? Didn't see him? David and Brian actually came to my brother's 21st when we were on holiday. It was quite exciting. And I'm pretty sure my brother did his backflip that night as well. He does it whenever he can get the opportunity to do a backflip, he'll do one. He's a bit of a show-off. Makes me a little bit jealous. Right, let's see what else we've got hiding behind these trees. Seen anything yet, David? Oh, that's cool. Look at that. A go-away bird. Can you still see the go-away bird, David? I don't know, but that's a lilac-breasted roller that's now hiding behind a branch. But at one point, very briefly, the go-away bird and the lilac-breasted roller, not the lilac-breasted roller, the European roller, sorry, were sitting on the same perch. But everybody's struggling to seat themselves down quite comfortably on branches today with this wind. Sorry, birds, it's not a good day to be you, is it? Unless you're a relatively large eagle, then it'll be quite nice because, well, you can use the wind to actually help soar and hover. And big birds like the Warburg's eagles and fish eagles and tawny eagles and all of those lovely birds, unfortunately, can't or are not true hoverers. It's a Nyala. It's only the pied kingfisher and the black-shouldered kite that are the true hovering species in South Africa. It's okay, girl. They've got all the bush to run around in, but they're literally just skimming past our vehicle, which was quite nice, so she couldn't have been that too frightened. Oh, now they've stopped. Look, now they're fine. Hey, guys. Now they've relaxed. Oh, that pesky aerial. Hey, David. Hello, Aloni and Armani. Now, as we are looking at the Nyala, which is unfortunately also a prey species to many of the predators out here, you were wondering, have I ever experienced any prey species hiding underneath my vehicle? I haven't. I haven't had a prey species go underneath my vehicle, but I have had about 6 wild dog puppies run underneath my vehicle. One morning, we were watching the Toulon pack. And back then it was 23 dogs, there were 13 adults and 10 pups. And anyway, the adults had just come back from a hunt. They'd taken down a bushbuck and common dacre and a bushbuck. And they'd fed, they'd come back, and the puppies are still a bit young, so they, oh sorry, it's got something in my eye. They, unfortunately, they're too young to go out on the hunt. There was one dog that was injured and it stayed around to look after the little ones. And basically they came back and they regurgitated, all the adults regurgitated the food, which was amazing to see. I always love that. And then, what was really exciting, is that the adults brought back, and now this may be a little bit gruesome, but just think of it as if we buy toys for our dogs and our cats. The adults brought back the head of the Nyala and the head of the common dacre, or it was a bushbuck, I've forgotten, I have to look back at my photos. And the puppies were playing with it. So they were playing and chasing each other and running around as the adults had a break and sat down and, well, recuperated after their hunt. And all of these puppies then were chasing each other around, and in the commotion, 6 of them just went straight underneath my vehicle. I was sitting there in absolute shock. It was amazing though, and then they came straight out again. But often you'll get lions lying right next to the vehicle, utilizing the shade. But no prey species, not like Brent having an Nyala jump in the vehicle to try and escape wild dogs. But we're gonna go back across to James now. And I'm really hoping that he manages to find the Nkuhumas for you.
Well, hopefully indeed, everybody. We're certainly running out of time now. We did have some alarm calling Franklin, so I got out of the car and I walked up to the Franklin and I said, "What do you see?" And the Franklin was sitting not more than, at one stage, about 6 feet from me on a tree, staring sort of intently. But I don't know if you've ever tried to see where a Franklin is seeing himself. It's not easy. Their beady little eyes seem to be looking 180 degrees. So I don't know what he was looking at. I suspect it was a snake. I thought it might be the lions. I spent some time walking around him, but then it appeared that he wasn't staring at anything that I could see. And as I am not completely blind, I assumed it wasn't lions, but quite possibly a snake that had taken one. Of his kith or kin. Now, we've come to the other side of quarantine clearings, to Rebecca's Road. Well, now, Heather, you say, how do the Safari Life crew get on so well with each other when we live in such close quarters? Well, Heather, who says we get on with each other? It's a little bit like the Rolling Stones, you know. I mean, I watch. An interview with Keith Richards the other day, and the interviewee said, "You know, are you friends with Mick Jagger?" And he said, "No, I'm not friends with Mick Jagger. I don't see him unless I have thought it was Rebecca, so went to Rebecca's room and threw a bucket of water on Rebecca. And basically, by the 9 o'clock yesterday evening, there were three or four different fist fights going on in the middle of the DRC. So, yeah, I mean, look, it's a stretch to say we all get on with each other, but we're very good at pretending we get on with each other, aren't we, Brian?
Yeah, indeed.
Yes. I am, of course, being entirely facetious, and it's one of the great mysteries of living out here for me. I've worked in many lodges in the close confines that we live in, and normally there's a lot of fighting. There's a lot of people getting on each other's nerves and getting irritated, and obviously one doesn't want to paint the picture of utopia here, but I'd say I have seldom been as astounded as I am by the lack of conflict in our camp, and I think it's amazing, especially given that the bunch of people I work with are, well, I mean, frankly, they're all weird. I mean, I'm hardly from the top of the normal draw myself, and you know, all of us are a little bit odd, to be honest. And how our various kinds of oddness don't result in conflict, I really don't know. And that's just the way it is. We do get on with each other pretty well. I mean, yes, of course, there's the odd snapped word here and there, but by and large, everyone just mucks in and gets on with it. Probably has something to do with sharing bathrooms, don't you think, Brian?
Yeah.
We just feel very close to each other.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's not something you have to think about, though. Right, we're going to do a little bit faster and go and do the western fringes of quarantine now. Thank you, Heather, for your question about how it is that we get on with each other so well. That's wonderful. And there's a big cloud coming up now from the west, so I'm sure this wind that's starting to blow is going to bring something in here. And just to keep you posted, the bushwalker, I'm afraid, didn't get up today. We're not sure what the problem is. We'll hopefully have it sorted by the morning. And if we don't, well, then I guess I will be back in the tent. I'm not sure I should go with this one or not. I don't think I'm going to. Humps here. Oh, Brian, quickly. Look how gorgeous that is, Brian.
Amazing.
Oh, that is just too beautiful for words. Stunning. So gorgeous. Now, if ever you come to Africa, I hope very much that you will get a sight like this, because as somebody said during our recent TV show, they said she travelled three continents, or lived in three continents, travelled five of them, but she'd never seen a sunset like she had in Africa. And you can see why, perhaps. You can also see how fast those clouds are moving. So something's up with the weather. Shall we wait for it to go down, Brian? I think we may as well. Oh, David in Napa. That's a very nice question from you. You say, who in the crew, if I could, would I throw to the lions? Well, David, it varies from day to day. Oh, just David, you're not in Napa, apparently, you're somewhere else. Right now I'd throw Louise to the lions. I don't know who I'd throw to the lions. I don't think I'd throw anyone to the lions. Let me think. I'd throw Gendre to the lions some days because he has the bathroom habits of an ill-educated ape. He is unable to dry himself in the shower and must dry himself on the concrete floor. And therefore, when you go in there, it looks like, it looks like Steph's deluge has taken place in there. Rebecca sometimes, she too seems to need the ablutionary facilities at exactly the same time that I do all the time. That is obviously distressing in a camp like ours. So, funny how these all revolve around the bathroom. I'm trying to think who else I would throw to the lions sometimes. Well, who would you throw, Brian? Other than me, of course. You throw Byron to the lions. Okay.
I couldn't think of anyone else.
So you chose the new guy?
Yeah, I chose.
Yes. Byron apparently is sitting in the final control and he says, I told you. I might throw the walking pack to the lions, although I think they would probably reject it out of hand. That was a gorgeous sunset, by the way, in case you hadn't noticed. All right, let's go across to Taylor and see if she can see the sun or perhaps the moon.
Now, James was having a conversation, obviously, with all of you about how all the amount of fighting that goes on. Of course, he's just talking nonsense. We don't fight ever. But what I'm about to tell you, I shouldn't probably even be mentioning it, but I'm just going to go out on a limb here this afternoon. And, well, serious scandal that was going on in the DRC camp. And, well, we had a bit of an issue a couple of days ago where our chocolate was going missing. And it's not funny, David. It was a serious problem. The slabs of chocolate were just disappearing, and it's ritual after dinner. We all have a small block of chocolate and it goes around the table. But we had no chocolate left, and it was very upsetting. And nobody was admitting to it, of course, which was quite upsetting. Except, 2 afternoons ago, mistakenly, Connor. Yes, you know Connor? The drone flyer, the engineer, admitted that he'd been eating at least a slab of chocolate a day. Can you believe that? That was the biggest upset in camp. It was on the front page of the local news. It really caused a bit of an uproar, and people were protesting. It was. I'm just joking, but yes, that actually did happen. We did have a problem in camp where our chocolate was going missing. We found the culprit now, and now we were going. I just actually wanted Louise to get nervous about what I was going to say next. We have quarantine. I'm so excited. Hopefully, I don't see the wildebeest around just yet, and apparently they're around the pan. So hopefully the wildebeest have now moved to the top of quarantine. Have they, David? Yes, they have. Look, they're right here. That's so cool. That's perfect. This is exactly what we wanted. This is so awesome. It's worked out just how I wanted it. We'll just wait for these wildebeest to cross the road, though. I don't want to chase them across. They're slowly moving that way, and then hopefully in the next couple of minutes we should be able to get a nice silhouette of them. Now, Justin, you're wondering, what are some of the pranks that we've played on people? Okay, I'm going to tell you one that I'd like to do to James, but you can't tell James, obviously. You've got to keep this hush-hush. Louise and Curse will probably agree with me. What we're going to do to James at some point is that, remember from Christmas we had all those antlers, the reindeer antlers, and had all the little bells on. I'm sure you remember the jingling, of course. Now, James wasn't here for Christmas. Remember, so don't put this on Twitter or anything. Like, we'll keep this a secret. So you're now involved in the prank that we're going to play on James. So the next time he has a bit of time off, we will do it. So what we're going to do is we're going to take the bells from the antlers, the reindeer antlers, our Christmas decorations. We're going to tie them on fishing gut, and we're going to put them underneath his bed. So we're going to tie them to the wooden frame, not very long, just a little bit long, so they can move around. So that every time James goes to bed, I mean, who looks under their mattress? I mean, nobody these days. So when James goes to bed and he moves around, he's going to hear a ching, 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 and he's not going to know where it's coming from. And I just think it's going to be absolutely hysterical. And I just can't wait for him to march out of his room saying, once he figures it out, or maybe he'll just lose his mind because he hasn't been able to figure it out. So that is what I'm going to do. Like I said, you can't tell him. You're going to be a part of this prank, and then maybe one day it'll pop up again where he'll tell you a story about how he was pranked, and then you'll know who the culprits were. But I think it'll be exceptionally funny. I think we can move over there now. They've crossed the road. Let's see. It's still a little bit light, but I would like to get a closer look at these wildebeest anyway, because these are the first wildebeest calves I've seen since last year. So I'm very excited. I cannot wait. Look how tiny they are. They're so little. Oh, they're such funny looking things. Right, now we're going to try and get the right angle. I suspect if we go a little bit further forward and if they go that way, sort of, if they go to their right, it might be quite nice. So let's pull off the road because I can see a couple of vehicles. Lots of vehicles trying to come past us. So we'll just park here. It's Eggsy! Look! Is it Eggsy? Yes! Hi, Zander! We live! Bye, Eggsy! He didn't even want to stop for a chat. Yes? Yes. So Eggsy's just told me he's fed us some wonderful information. He said that there's an elephant on the corner of the plains, but he looks very angry. So I think he was warning us. I think he's telling us not to go there. But we might have to go and visit the angry elephant, because he could provide us, of course, with a silhouette opportunity. And we're not going to say no to one of those. And thankfully, this camera's got the most wonderful zoom, so we'll definitely be able to get him from a safe distance. But how precious are these little wildebeest? This is just amazing. And David, you were telling me that you had a wonderful experience with Evia and the little wildebeest, that how blended in it was on the sand. I've got hiccups now, as the little one was sleeping next to Mom. Yeah, very well camouflaged. That's very interesting. Now, I don't know. It looks as though these wildebeests are getting settled in. Chris, you were wondering if there's anything that... There's the angry elephant! Sorry, David, I just saw it pop out of the screen. It was running. Now, it's gone behind the trees. Let me go back, David. Sorry, Chris, I'm going to get to your question now. That angry elephant just caught my eye. Oh, it's shouting. Oh, it's actually coming here. Maybe it's going to chase the wildebeest. I'm going to go... That's not first gear. Sorry, Chris, I'll get back to your question. Here it comes. It's going to pop out. There's our angry elephant. You can see ears flared, tail lifted away from his body. Now, James apparently saw this elephant. I don't know why he's so angry, but he's running towards the wildebeest now and towards us. What's wrong, big boy? He's going to chase the wildebeest. David, I just want to... No, we should be fine. He's now changing direction. Maybe he spotted the lions or something that he's got such a fright. But wildebeest, be careful, because I think he... Oh, no. I'm also now moving out of the way, everyone. Whee! Don't chase us. Don't be rude. The reason why I am moving is not because I'm scared of him. It's just because I don't want to be stampeded by the wildebeest. He's still coming. Where's he going? Is he coming after us? Oi. Oi, 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 oi. You settle down there. I'm just watching him. David's going to have to be my eyes because now I can't see him. Hey, what's wrong? Stop your nonsense. Now I'm just going to stop briefly because he needs to settle down. He can't chase us. He's a young Ellie, and I don't know what's made him so cross. I don't think it's us. It's something else. Maybe it's the wind as well. The wind tends to stir these animals. I just raised my voice just a little bit, just to let him know, because I don't have a door to sort of make a noise. Here we go. Now he's settling down. That's good. And I also don't want him to, of course, get the feeling that he can chase vehicles. Because I don't know if he was chasing us or if he was chasing the wildebeest, but I had to move out of the way either way. Because the poor wildebeest were then trapped between the angry elephant, and myself, and I didn't want them to panic with their little ones. So that's why I moved, just out of the way. But now he's not trumpeting. He seems to be a little bit more relaxed now. But Eggsy was right, it was definitely an angry elephant. It's okay, big boy, everything will be all right. But it was a bit like a bowling ball steaming down and straight towards the wildebeest, which were sort of, well, I suppose the pins. They all went scattering, hey David? Yep. They weren't hanging around with that elephant. And I don't think that it'll be the first time that those young wildebeests will be charged by another animal. It happens quite often, actually. But I'm glad that he's settled down and, well, the wildebeest are acting as if nothing has even happened to them. Look how relaxed they are. One little calf has even gone back to sleep. Arbeard, you say that the reason why the elephant was maybe angry is because he's thinking to himself, who stole my chocolate? He's probably hunting down Connor as we speak. He probably picked up his scent and realized that he's the chocolate thief. Now, Chris, I'm so sorry. You had a question for me earlier about if anything preys upon wildebeest, or hunts wildebeest, I think that was the question. And I apologize that I didn't get to it straight away, but there was just so much commotion going on. I didn't know what to think or what to say, of course. But yes, there is. Lions love to catch wildebeest. And small wildebeest will be caught by leopards, by cheetah, by lions, wild dogs. Wild dogs, if it's a big enough pack, they might even be able to take down an adult. So there are quite a few different predators that will go after a wildebeest, of course. Now I'm just keeping an eye on this elephant, because every now and then he turns around and he looks towards us. And I'd like a fair amount of warning if he is charging towards us. But I don't think we're going to get any success with a silhouette from these wildebeest, as they're all sitting down now, finding a nice soft spot in the grass out in the open. Some of them still grazing away one last time. But these little things are just absolutely precious. And I love that tawny color that they are when they are first born. But you can see a couple of them are already going sort of chocolate brown now. And before you know it, they'll be all grown up. But not for now. We'll just watch these little ones as they eat the grass. And look how fluffy their tails are. Oh, they're so cute. These two, I think to me, baby wildebeest have to be one of the sweetest things. And I think this is the only time that a wildebeest is cute. But what a lovely creature. And I think they also like hyenas, a little bit misunderstood. People are reluctant to like wildebeest, but I like them quite a bit. Oh, a little head tussle. Look, you can see their little horns poking out already. They grow up so fast, don't they? Here we go, pushing each other. Mom, could you mind just taking two steps to the left, please, so we can watch the little ones? You could just sort of see a bit of movement, just the bums on either side. Here we go. Isn't that sweet? And of course, to them, they're having a great time. They're intimidating each other, pushing each other around. Oh, even on the knees now, like the adults. Getting a little bit more rough now. And I wish you could hear the noise that they're making, that meh, 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 as they giggle about with each other. Look at the view of the mom. I don't know if you're watching on the right-hand corner of the screen as mom was grooming herself, but she was pulling the most hilarious face as she was biting her skin. Obviously, there was a bit of an itch. Now, we don't see too many animals down on their knees feeding, except really the warthogs. But look at this little one every now and then goes down onto its knees. Just a moment ago, it was actually grazing. That was really nice to see as well. Hello, Mom. Mom, we're watching the creche of little ones. Also, two steps to the right, please, so that we can see what's going on. But yes, look at that one female who's sort of sitting with all of the calves. Oh, they are so precious. This is just, there we go. Look how that's the funniest face that they pull when they groom. Now, a really interesting question that's just come through from Colleen. Colleen wants to know, will they make a protective circle around the little ones if there's sort of danger around? We see that a lot with elephants. Oh! Oh! Looks like all the cows are having a dispute now. Just maybe getting a little bit too close to one of the calves. Oh, here comes a wildebeest now running in from the back. I wonder who is that charging in. There he comes. Maybe it's a male. Let's see. Yes, it is a beautiful big male. He must be happy to see these girls. He looks very chuffed, doesn't he? Very, very proud dad, I'm sure. David, what was I just talking about before they started chasing each other? I've forgotten. Oh, yes. So, sorry, the question was, will the adults protect the little ones by circling around them? So, like I said, elephants do it all the time. A wildebeest, what they'll do is normally the calf will try and run right next to mom at her side, and they'll go gallivanting off into the distance. But they don't protect them like what an elephant will. I have seen a video, though, of a leopard trying to take a wildebeest calf, and mom actually coming through and intervening and trying to horn the leopard and chop it and kick it and all those types of things. So to an extent, they of course will try and protect them, but they also know that in a year's time they can have another calf, so they might also let them go. Now, I didn't quite hear what Louise said to me, but she said that we need to shoot across to James because he's got something else to show you.
No, he doesn't. He's got nothing at all. I'm afraid we've done a loop around every single block where I think the lions could possibly have been. Haven't found them. They haven't popped out. I found where Herbert was trying to track them. I have not found a lion track though, and I think this blustery weather is really bad, bad news for those wildebeest, which is deeply sad. Ugh. It's blowing up. It's blowing up a storm, it is. Alright everybody, Taylor is with the wildebeest, who I think are about to have a very tough time of it. Thank you for coming on safari with us. We had a wonderful chat earlier on, especially. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
And the balloon thumb. Very nice. I don't think I've seen a balloon thumb before. Let's head across back to Taylor now and we'll see you all in the morning at 0500. Bye-bye.
Well, the wildebeest seem to have settled down now again as that male came charging through just to make sure that everything was all right with his ladies. He seemed to be a little bit panicked. And our friend the elephant has now also disappeared. He's gone somewhere else to go and, well, I suppose chase away other animals. There's a cloud I want to show you. It's a beautiful cloud. We just need to head up over here so we can try and find a spot where we can see it between the trees. I hope you're excited, and I hope the wind doesn't blow the cloud away now. Let's go up here. David, can you see which cloud I'm looking at?
I think so.
You think so? What do you think it looks like?
No.
You don't know?
No.
Right, we're going to get a gap in about 2 seconds. I'm trying to get there as quick as I can. We're going to get a gap. No. Here we go. I think we'll sit at this termite mound and we should be good. There's this lovely sort of low sort of stream of clouds forming. Oh, it's changed a little bit, that big cloud that you can see between the trees. But at one moment, it looked like an elephant with its ears open and its trunk. But the clouds have now shifted slightly and, well, it looks like a big blob at the moment, which is slightly unfortunate. But we shall maybe try some more cloud watching tomorrow. But isn't it just a beautiful scene anyway? But sadly, it's time for us to now say goodbye to all of you. But I hope that you've enjoyed another fun afternoon out here with us driving around on the Sabi sand. It's been fantastic. And hopefully we'll continue the cat streak tomorrow morning. Maybe the kahumas make an appearance. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you for the sunrise safari. From everybody, the whole Wild Earth team, have a lovely day.